Well, good evening, everyone. It's good to be off to go ahead and tune in tonight. Tonight, for our home group, we are in the last chapter of the book of Romans, Romans chapter 16. And to be honest, I really haven't given much thought yet on where we're going to go from here. We're still praying about it. And yes, next week we'll have a study. And, I'll just, if you have anything you'd like to cover, just leave it in the comments or, text me or Alicia to let us know something that maybe you think, we're a little interested in this. It doesn't necessarily have to be a book. If it's a doctrinal issue that you need a little bit of clarification on, things like that, where I'm open to that. Those that remember a long, long time ago, our first series was on prayer. We don't necessarily have to revisit that, but that's kind of an example of what I'm talking about, is some type of question about, why we believe what we believe as Christians and so forth. But tonight, at any rate, we will finish off Romans 16. This has been quite the book we've gone through. I mean, if you think about it, just how much has happened since we started all those months ago, through the book of Romans, all the disruptions and obviously coronavirus resorting to, doing this type of study, which, again, I have no problem with, but I really do miss everybody. I miss our dinners that we have at 6 and then moving into the study at 7, but at least we're still getting the word. That's important. We may not be being fed physically like we normally do, but we definitely are getting fed spiritually. So let's go ahead and pray. Father, we just thank you for this time we have together. We ask you now, Father, just to open our eyes to this last chapter of the book of Romans, which there's mostly a lot of greetings to different people, but there's still lessons to be learned. And we ask you to open our eyes and our ears to the Spirit to show us what we need to know from this particular chapter. And we give tonight to you, we give this time of study to you, in Jesus' name, amen. So, as is normal for most of Paul's letters, he finishes off with greetings to everyone. And we're going to kind of go through a few of them and talk about them instead of reading the whole thing. But what's interesting is the number of people that Paul greets to a church he's never been to. And remember, from the very beginning, Paul had never, at this point in time, he was still in Corinth, he was writing this letter, but he never had visited the church in Rome, okay? But he knew a lot of people there who were very active in the church in Rome. And we're going to see some of these people, and a lot of the names are going to sound familiar because we will have seen those names in Acts, we'll have seen them in a lot of the other epistles, and you're also going to see not just Paul greeting people at the church, but people in Corinth sending their own greetings. And what we see here is Paul is a rather social person. And to be honest, this is not an unusual thing for really powerful ministers and really powerful preachers out there, that they have a lot of Christian friends, fellow laborers in the ministry. I can think of very few who are truly, hermits. It's kind of interesting how in the old days they thought if you wanted to be really pious, you became a nun or a monk, and you basically cut yourself off from everybody else. And to be terribly honest, that is not what Christ or the church needs, is people staying to themselves. We are to go out in all the world. And we are not to go out alone, okay? When Jesus sent out the disciples, back in the Gospels, the first time around, there were 70 of them he sent out, okay? And they were in groups. They went along and they supported one another. They prayed for one another. They did great and wondrous miracles. And Paul himself was never alone, okay? We see a lot we hear of, in each epistle, and here too, all these different people he knows, he's worked with, he greets them, and they're with him. They're sending their regards to whomever he's writing to. This is, and Paul was a powerful preacher. We're not going to mince words here. He was very, you know, instrumental, as he admits, to preaching the gospel to the Gentiles at that time. So as we look through this, keep that in the back of our minds too, is effective ministry is teamwork. And you need to be on, you know, good terms with the people you work with. Now, granted, Paul wasn't perfect. He had arguments, but God used those arguments with other people to spread the gospel. You think of at the very beginning, Paul and Barnabas, they did this great missionary journey. And then Paul says, hey, let's go back and visit the churches, you know, when it's been done, see how everyone's doing. Barnabas said, okay, I want to take my, nephew here, John, or John Mark, as we know, the writer of the book of Mark. And because Mark had abandoned them early on in the first journey, Paul wanted nothing to do with it. And that caused a rather sharp disagreement between Paul and Barnabas. And so Barnabas did go back and visit all the other churches, but what was Paul going to do? He went with Silas and decided, let's go and plant more churches. So God used that disagreement to further the church. And as we read later in 2 Timothy, Paul refers to Mark as a fellow laborer. So at some point they became reconciled. I think Mark was just a young lad. He just couldn't handle the rigors of that type of journey. And he realized later that he had to mature more. And now Paul thinks of him as a valuable tool. So God uses all these different things that happen between people for his good. So we're looking at starting at verse 1 of chapter 16. I commend to you Phoebe, our sister, who is a servant of the church in Cenchrea, that you may receive her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints, and assist her in whatever business she has need of you, for indeed she has been a helper of many and of myself also. So the first person we see is Phoebe. Okay, we know very little about her. The word servant here could also be translated as deaconess, since it is the female version of that particular Greek word. And Cenchrea or Cenchrea, depending on how that's pronounced, was the chief port close by to Corinth. So there was obviously a church there, and Phoebe obviously was a believer, and now she's on her way to Rome, and Paul's basically saying, hey, when she gets there, take care of her. And the implication here is that she's actually the one carrying this letter to the church in Rome. Okay, so Paul wrote the letter. He's going to send it with Phoebe. Phoebe now is going to Rome. Many scholars think she was some type of businesswoman, much like Lydia in Philippi. What her business was, again, we don't know. Phoebe was a fairly common name in the Roman Empire at that time in Greece. So other than this, we really do not know much more about her. Paul basically emphasizes her service. She was a servant, you know, a helper of many and to himself. So he's sending her with the highest credentials. And basically this was very common when travelers went from place to place among the Christian churches. If they got a recommendation from an elder at one of the churches, the new church they went into would take that letter and say, oh yeah, okay, we know who you are, come on in. And they'd take care of the person, whoever it was. And so Phoebe is the first one mentioned. It's also interesting to note that Phoebe, of course, is a woman, and a lot of people don't think twice about the fact that a good portion of the people Paul is greeting or referring to here are women. And this, in our modern day, we don't think much about, but in this period of time, ancient Rome and ancient Greece during the empire, this was a very unusual thing to do, because women generally had very few rights. They had less rights than men. If they were single, they could hold property and they could run businesses, but as soon as they got married, that right disappeared. They essentially became property. And a lot of people who claim that Christianity is a sexist religion, that they don't deal with equality of women have never really read the New Testament, okay? And if they look at it, they'll see that women are treated in a radical way in the view of the time. And you have to understand the historical context to see just how radical Paul's and the Christian church's view of women were. They essentially treat them as equals. We don't give that a second thought today. Ancient Rome, totally different story. So moving on, verse 3. We have here a couple of people that we've heard of before. Verse 3, greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Jesus Christ, who risked their own necks for my life, to whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Likewise, greet the church that is in their house. Priscilla and Aquila first appear on the scene in the book of Acts. Paul managed to run into them, and what we see is that they were all tent makers. Paul, even though he is a religious leader among the Jews, his chosen profession in order to support himself in case he had to was tent making. And at one point, Paul made it quite clear to the different churches that he didn't want them to support him. So he worked as a tent maker to support himself. Now, he worked at it that way. He didn't say that no one should be paid for by the church. He's very much into give the worker his wages, but he himself chose to forego that right, and so he worked as a tent maker, and Priscilla and Aquila were as well. And what we see from them is they actually did come from Rome. That was their home, and during the reign of Emperor Claudius, the Jews were expelled from the city of Rome, and so that's where Priscilla and Aquila show up on the scene with Paul in Asia. And we see them a couple of times in the book of Acts helping Apollos along. Apollos was preaching. They were listening to him. They got the idea. Yeah, you know what you're talking about, but let's correct a few things. So they took him under their wing and proceeded to bring him back up in the way, in the true ways of Christianity, since apparently he was preaching something that was a little off. Maybe not downright heresy, but something that wasn't correct. But he took the instruction, and from what we've heard, Apollos was a very powerful speaker, very powerful teacher within the Christian church at this time. And so Priscilla and Aquila, now they're back in Rome. Right now Nero is emperor. Of course, when we think of Nero, we think of bad things, but at this point he was okay. He actually did not view Christians as the enemy. He was very supportive of them. But so the Jews were back in Rome, and Priscilla and Aquila apparently had a church in their house, okay, which was again very common in those days. The whole idea of a huge monster facility for a church had not entered into Christianity at this point in time. In fact, if we were to look at the book of Acts, when the church got too big, God split them up. Okay, they scattered them, but the main venue in most of the churches was living at home. Okay, moving on, we're still now in the middle of verse 5. Greet my beloved Epaphroditus, who is the first fruits of Achaia to Christ. Greet Mary, who labored much for us. Greet Andronicus and Junia, my countrymen and my fellow prisoners, who are of note among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me. Okay, these are people we don't know very much about. Okay, just from what Paul says here, Epaphroditus was apparently the first believer in Achaia, which we now call Asia or Asia Minor. He was Paul's first convert, so he held a special place in his heart, and apparently he came from Rome as well. Greet Mary, who labored much for us, another woman who's a servant. Okay, Mary was a Semitic name, so perhaps she was Jewish. But again, not much more is known. Andronicus and Junia, my countrymen and my fellow prisoners. Basically, these two gentlemen apparently were Jews, when he says my fellow countrymen, and apparently spent some time in jail with Paul. Paul, as we know, when he went from city to city, he found out first where the Jews met, and second, what were the jails like, because he knew he was going to end up there at some point in time during his visit. And so at some point, these two Jews from Rome were prisoners with Paul. And it's interesting, he says, they're of note among the apostles. Now, we're not talking about like Paul the apostle or Peter the apostle. The term apostle merely means teacher. And so it's used in a broad sense in the Greek at this point, as he's of note among the teachers, okay? So apparently they are very good teachers, and they were in Christ before. Their Christian, their salvation predated Paul's, okay? So again, they're Romans, so they're there in Rome. Verse 8, greet Amplius, my beloved in the Lord. Greet Urbanus, our fellow worker in Christ, and Stachius, my beloved. Greet Apelles, approved in Christ. Greet those who are of the household of Aristobulus. Greet Herodion, my countryman. Greet those who are of the household of Narcissus, who are in the Lord. Again, very little known about any of these. A lot of fellow workers. He really has a close, when he calls someone my beloved, he has a close relationship with them. He knows them very personally. Approved in Christ, that statement just barely means that this person is doing his work in the way and that the Lord has approved of him. When we refer to those who are in the household of Aristobulus or of Narcissus, a lot of those are probably slaves, okay? But apparently there's a lot of them that Paul knows and he's aware of them. Herodion, another Jew, possibly related in some way to the family of Herod's in Judea. Many of Herod's relatives did live in Rome. So, you know, very likely that this was one of them. And he became a believer at this point as well. Verse 12. Greet Tryphena and Tryphosa, who have labored in the Lord. Greet the beloved Persis, who labored much in the Lord. Greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother and mine. Greet Asyncritus, Phlegon, Hermas, Patrobas, Hermes, and the brethren who are with them. Greet Philologus and Julia, Nerusius and his sister, Olympus, and all the saints who are with them. Okay, Tryphena and Tryphosa, I just want to mention, they're sisters, okay? And it's very common, and still common even today, in some families to name two sisters with very similar names. For example, I have three cousins. They all have the same middle name. There was Tina June, Gretel June, and Katrina June. And that was just something that, you know, my aunt and uncle did. But it was very common in Greek times for this to happen. Sounded familiar, had very similar meanings. And again, this is just a list of people who labored much. I do want to point out Rufus in verse 13. His father was Simon of Cyrene, the man who carried the cross of Christ. So there's a lot of speculation at this point that this is the same one, that experience of carrying the cross of Christ to Calvary, to Golgotha, allowed this family to be saved. So if that's the case, Rufus was probably welcome because he saw Christ. Granted, he saw him at his crucifixion, but he saw Christ. So he would probably be very honored among the believers, but he is chosen in the Lord. And when he talks about his mother, Rufus's mother, and Paul says his mother and mine, it's not that Paul's mother is alive. Chances are she probably was not. And if she was, she didn't want anything to do with him anyway. Because remember, Paul, when he became a Christian, essentially the Jews viewed him as turning his back on their beliefs. So as far as they were concerned, Paul was a turncoat. He was dead. And if his mother was a very devout Jew, she felt the same way. She wouldn't want to see Paul anyway. But what Paul here in Romans is saying, that Rufus's mother, it was like a mother to him. That's why he made that particular statement. Verse 16, greet one another with a holy kiss. The churches of Christ greet you. Okay, so he's talking about the churches in and around Corinth and that particular region of Greece. Greeting one another with a holy kiss is, you know, he's making it say that so it doesn't sound weird. People greeted one another with a kiss on the cheek, you know, and you'll still see this, how long that's going to last after this coronavirus thing goes by, but you'll still see this in southern cultures like in Italy and in Greece, is when they come, even men will come up here, they'll kiss each other on the cheek. And it's just a greeting, okay? Some people get kind of freaked out by that, but that's just our American culture. A lot of southern European cultures, this is perfectly normal. And again, I don't know if that's going to stay that way. You know, we'll see. So, churches in Christ greet you. Now we move on to verse 17, where it seems like he's changing the subject. But really what's happening here is the first of several postscripts, I call them. Excuse me, it's kind of dry up here. Okay. Verse 17. Now I urge you, brethren, note those who cause division and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learned, and avoid them. For those who are such do not deserve our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by smooth words and flattering speech deceive the hearts of the simple. For your obedience has become known to all. Therefore, I am glad on your behalf, but I want you to be wise in what is good and simple concerning evil. And the God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. Paul had a lot of enemies. He had a lot of people, especially among Judaizers, who were Christians who never did accept the decision of the First Council of Jerusalem, which we see in Acts 15, basically saying that no, Gentiles do not have to become Jewish proselytes to become Christians. They don't have to. So therefore, and for these guys, these Judaizers disagreed with that. And they didn't care if Paul or Peter or James or anybody else said, no, we don't have to do it. They know they're right. So Paul had no end of trouble with people following him. He'd go and plant a church, and then these Judaizers would practically show up on his tail and start saying, oh, Paul wasn't right. Here's how you have to do it. And the whole point of the book of Galatians, for example, was to address that particular problem, is that, you know, why you guys falling away from this gospel so quickly. And he goes through and talks about why the Judaizers are wrong using scripture. And he's giving that kind of warning here. We do know, because of the trouble the Judaizers gave to Paul, that they probably did keep track of what he was doing. Now, whether or not he had somebody, like a spy within his entourage as he moved around, is not clear. But he basically was thinking to himself, look, there's a good chance that Judaizers are going to find out I'm going to head to Rome. So they're going to try to get there before me to poison the water. Okay, we're going to muddy up the well up here. And when Paul shows up, he's not going to be received with any type of respect. So he's wanting to make it clear, look, watch out for these guys. Okay, and he's not accusing any one person or even a group of people in particular. He's basically saying these are people who teach false teachings. They cause divisions. They don't teach the correct doctrine. They have, you know, when he says, but they don't serve the Lord, but their own belly. They're in it for the money, basically. They're in it for the prestige. They're in it for the power. It's kind of like, well, how Jesus described the Pharisees. They like going to the respectful greetings on the street, or going to a banquet and being given the best seats, and all the adulation and honor due to a Pharisee. In essence, Jesus is saying that's why they're in this. They're not in it for the people. They're certainly not in it for the welfare of the saints. And he says there are Christians who are the same way. And even to this day, we know this. There are Christians to this day who are not in it for the love of the people. They're in it for the love of money. Okay, you wouldn't think being a preacher could make a lot of money, but if you're a darn good teacher and you say the right things. And a lot of times the right things don't come from the Bible. You say the right things, yeah, you can make a lot of money. Okay. You can sit there and preach any doctrine you want, as long as it's a feel-good doctrine, something, a sermon that tickles the ears so it feels wonderful. You can make a lot of money at being a preacher. And that's what Paul's talking about here. It's like, yeah, watch out for these guys. They're smooth operators. They'll come in, they'll sound like they know what they're talking about. And yeah, they're going to insist that you pay their way because, hey, they're guest speakers. They deserve an honorarium, which is true. Any guest speaker at a church does deserve an honorarium. But as Paul says, hey, just watch out for them. Be aware they're there. And he has a lot of confidence. He says, I am glad on your behalf, but I want you to be wise in what is good and simple concerning evil. He's saying if it sounds too good to be true, it probably is. And he says, I believe you guys have the discernment to tell the right from the wrong. And so he's giving them a warning, but you can tell he's not that worried about it. Just a simple, simple warning about watch out for the false teachers. And then it seems like he's about ready to wrap it up. And we have the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. And then we go to verse 21. Now this is the postscript. Okay. Verse 21, Timothy, my fellow worker, and Lucius, Jason, and Sosipater, my countrymen, greet you. I, Tertius, wrote this epistle, greet you in the Lord. Gaius, my host, and the host of the whole church, greet you. Erastus, the treasurer of the city, greets you. And Quartus, a brother. All the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. So now these are people who are Paul. These are people in the church at Corinth. Timothy, of course, we know who we're talking about. Timothy, the recipient of the books of 1st and 2nd Timothy. We see him appear on the scene in Acts, and he's been indispensable to Paul throughout his entire ministry. Lucius, we're not sure who he is. Some scholars think this is just the Romanization of the name Luke, which would make sense because Luke, the author of the book of Luke and the book of Acts, was a companion of Paul pretty much to the end. And it would make sense that if you're writing to Romans, he may not be known by the name Luke. But Lucius, okay, now we know who you're talking about. It was not uncommon for people to have different names in different languages. Remember, Paul was like that. His Roman name was Paul or Paulus, whereas his Jewish name was Saul, such as in King Saul. And Jason and Sosipater, my countrymen, greet you, fellow Jews. Tertius, it was very common for Paul, because a lot of scholars think he had very poor eyesight. It was very common for Paul to dictate his letters to somebody, to a secretary. And Tertius basically took this opportunity, probably asked, hey, can I say hi? Yeah, go ahead. I, Tertius, who wrote this epistle, greet you in the Lord. It's kind of like in a, you know, photograph, hi, Mom, you know, that kind of thing. You know, just, you know, if you see people on the back of a, you know, back of a TV, like a news interview, you got people waving and saying, hi, Mom. That's kind of what it has here. And the rest, Gaius, was the home in which Paul was staying. And the host of the whole church, talking about everyone there, mentioning Erastus, the treasurer of the city of Corinth. So, you know, showing that not only is God interested in the weak, he's interested in the people in high places, and that he will bless them if they devote their lives to him, even if they are part of the government. And then we got another ending, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Then it's the postscript. Okay, PPPS. The benediction, verse 25. Now to him who is able to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery kept secret since the world began, but now made manifest by the prophetic scriptures made known to all nations, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, for obedience to the faith, to God alone wise, be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. And how he's done. So his final benediction, just one last reminder of the nature of what of the God they serve. That, yeah, God has, there are things about Christianity we do not understand, things about God we definitely don't understand, and not to really worry about it. He's basically saying, keep in mind, guys, you know, God alone is wise, so give him the glory, give him the honor, give him the praise. And thus endeth the book of Romans. So, kind of stopped a little early, which is okay. We would have done this even when we worked together. But just think about all the things we learned in this book we went through. It talked about weaker Christians protecting, or stronger Christians protecting the weaker Christians. The stronger Christians bringing up weaker Christians because, you know, to help them grow more in the faith. Because a lot of times the new Christians now are the next generation of church leaders to keep the faith moving. And also the whole point of Christian liberty, which of course has always been something of a debate among a lot of people, that yes, we have the right to do everything, but does that mean it's the right thing to do? And also, how does it reflect Christ? And most of all, how does it affect others? And so a lot of lessons we have learned, a lot we went through this. Romans is probably one of the most powerful epistles that has a lot of things in it that's important for the Christian life. And I challenge you to read through it again, okay? And if you have questions, let me know what the questions are, and I'll do my best to answer them. I don't claim to be this brilliant theologian or brilliant scholar in the scriptures. I do my best. I'm just one of those guys who's serving the Lord the best way I can. It's nice to have been a teacher for so long. It does help. But that's a gift the Lord gave me, and that's nothing I did myself. So if you have any needs or prayer requests, let us know. You know, let me know in the comments. Go ahead and text Alicia. Let her know. Let me know. We'll pray for you. I do not know yet when we are going to be meeting again in person at our place in Monroe, but we'll let you know. And we're mindful of the social distancing. I personally, we're watching the numbers, and we're noticing that things are slowly ramping up here in the central Utah district. They're up to 21 full cases now, whereas a couple days ago it was only 17. But we don't know. Lord is in control. We're just using whatever wisdom he gives us to make those decisions. But we'll let you know, and it'll be great. We'll have a nice barbecue or something now that the weather's getting really nice. I mean, I have to admit, I like coming up here. I think I'm going to miss that an awful lot when we do come back together because, well, as you can see, I mean, just show you just what I'm sitting here looking at, you know, all the fun of, you know, being up near Monroe Peak and being out in God's creation. It really is, to me, a lot of fun. And this is actually where I was last week, except it was too cold last week, so I was sitting in the Jeep. So here we are now in the same spot. So hopefully if you've been looking over my shoulder at the view, that's fine. It's worth looking at, certainly worth looking at more than me. Yeah, looking at in the other direction, we got all the trees. You've probably been heard whistling during this entire message. So Father, we now close this time together, and we thank you for all you've done for us. We thank you for the miracle of the internet, the miracle that we can still come together and be with one another, even though we're separate physically. And Father, we just ask you to look over all those members of our home group. I want to bring Becky before you right now, with her niece coming in, and you know, she's stressed out for all the different things that are happening in her life now, Father. But she has that servant's heart, kind of like what we see of Phoebe here in Romans 16, that serving as many as she can. And I ask you to just give her the strength to continue serving. And give her the wisdom on how to proceed with all the different issues that she has to deal with. And again, Father, we just want you to be with you know, with everyone in the group, and preserve them, keep them healthy, keep them safe, and most of all, keep them protected and comforted in this time until we all meet again. And so, Father, we just give our praise to you, our thanks to you, in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, guys, so hope you enjoy tonight. Next week, we'll let you know next week where we're headed. Lisa will send out a group text like she always does. And again, if you have anything, if there's anything people are really interested in looking at a bit more, let us know, and I'll take that into account. That's the beauty of home group. We can actually do this in such a way as to make sure that everybody is covered. After all, that's what we're here for, is to help you along in your walk. So have a great evening, and we'll see you next week.